This is the current federal tax developments for the week of August the 17th, 2020. Current federal tax developments are brought to you by Kaplan Financial Education and by your State Society of CPAs. This week, we're going to look at a number of developments that took place over the past week, and we're going to have some brand new developments from the SBA this week, which is probably the major context we're going to be looking at. But we'll also take a look at a case of a taxpayer who attempted to use the code in a way that's allowed but not necessarily intended, and discovered that when you go down that path, there's a very good chance that the IRS is not going to give you a, oh, don't worry about it, it's fine, even if you pay for a private letter ruling. We'll also talk about the Ninth Circuit reviewing a case we discussed a year ago that looked at the question of a taxpayer who is a real estate professional. And in this case, interestingly enough, it's a little bit weird, but the IRS was trying to argue that certain activities were not rental activities. And in this case, the service wins on that. And we'll talk about why they weren't and the issue that came into it. And also, the IRS ended up dealing with a little problem. If you haven't heard, mail stacked up a bit at the IRS while they were shut down for all those weeks. And so the IRS this week gave taxpayers a little bit of relief if, because the money hasn't cleared their bank account, the check to pay the taxes hasn't come out of their bank account in weeks, and they forget about that check and suddenly don't have enough funds in the account, the IRS is going to grant some relief on the penalty that you normally get charged when you have a dishonored check presented to the IRS. But let's go ahead and start with our first issue this week, which is a taxpayer who is looking for a private letter ruling. This is private letter ruling 2020-033-008. If you're not sure how private letter rulings are numbered, basically, private letter rulings are numbered referencing the week of the year, which would be 33 at this point, and then 2020 is obviously 2020, the week of the year, and then the number of the ruling. And this was just, they issued, I think, 8 rulings this week of some sort. And it's not all private letter rulings. It also includes chief counsel advice and some other documents get in this weekly dump, which, interestingly enough, appeared a day early this week. Normally, they put them in there early on Friday. Sometimes it's late on Friday. But this time, it appears that it went in fairly early on Thursday. So it was kind of interesting that we got a look at this earlier than normal. So the problem in this case involves something that I think every one of us has had a client tell them about, or at least has, they know clients have talked about it. And it's the concept of borrowing from your IRA. And I'm sure you've had clients make reference to this transaction. And as we all know, there's nothing in the Internal Revenue Code that says a taxpayer may borrow from their IRA. In fact, you're told specifically that borrowing from that IRA is one of those prohibited transactions that creates a total disaster if you do it. So, but what we know, what they're really talking about here is making use of the ability of a taxpayer to take funds from a retirement account, and if it's a qualified rollover distribution, replace funds into another account within 60 days, or actually it's another or the same account actually within 60 days, and have that treated as a tax-free rollover. So we don't worry about the fact they got the funds. Now, catch with that, of course, is it was not designed to be a way to let people borrow from their IRA. And in fact, there are some things that get in the way of doing that, not the least of which is the once per 12 month rule. So once you do one of these, it's going to have to wait 12 more months before you try to do one again. So you have to like hold off, put the money in, hold off 12 months, and then do it again if you're going to be doing these short-term borrowings. And generally, this is a dangerous strategy, but one that is, as the IRS has admitted, it's allowed by the law because nothing in the law blocks it. Nothing in the law says that once you take the funds from the retirement account, that you're not allowed to spend them. Reality is cash is fungible, so there'd be no way really to enforce that rule. But the service has indicated that if that's in fact what you did and you later come back and try to get relief, don't be surprised if you don't get any. Well, this is one of those cases where a taxpayer decided to look for relief anyway. And we can ask, why would you look for relief anyway? Because we know why you'd like to have it, but the problem is, we also know the history is, it doesn't ever win. Normally, somebody has a claim against somebody's malpractice policy over this issue. claiming, you know, there's a lawsuit or some other claim that's arising, and some party is saying, well, we're not going to compensate you until you've tried everything. So we end up sometimes, and I always suspect in a case like this with a ruling that appears anybody should have known was highly unlikely to be issued, that the IRS, you know, that basically somebody is pushing for this, hoping that the IRS will give relief, because if they do, they won't be writing damage checks, or at least they won't have to go through the possibility of litigation over damages. So let's talk about what the taxpayer did. In this case, the taxpayer withdrew IRA funds. The taxpayer was looking at acquiring a new residence. Obviously, like a lot of us, there's a problem they might have. You know, you've got your residence, but currently, your current residence is not exactly cash, right? You know, it's sitting there. It's, you know, it's not something you can easily access the value of. So I would like to make a cash offer on the property because, bottom line, in this case, I would like to do that normally because I think I'll get a better deal. You know, if I can go to somebody trying to sell a, let's say, a house, and I can tell them, you know, the other person who's looking to buy the house and is bidding against me will have to go through a process of getting formal approval, having the bank approve the loan, go through all the inspections and all the other things that will have to be done, go ahead and get appraisal done by the lender and all those things before we can close the sale. And on the other side of this, I've got somebody who is merely going to put cash on the table, and therefore we're going to eliminate all of those other issues. We're just going to essentially have to close out and, you know, do some basic title search protection and that sort of thing. But other than that, not really worried. So we'd like to do this. And apparently this guy was advised by his real estate agent that he should think about doing this. That, you know what, you can take money out of your IRA because you've got all this in the retirement account. You've got a lot of money in IRA, and we have to assume that we're not talking about taking $5,000 out. Right? If you're going to make a cash offer on a residence, you know, we're going to have to assume that we are talking multiple six figures, and so not a small amount of problem if this turns out to be taxable. In any event, the real estate agent talked to him about doing this, and apparently never mentioned that he had to get it back in 60 days. Well, he went to the financial advice, you know, he went to the custodian site, and apparently, you know, went to the custodian, got the forms to request a withdrawal, and nowhere on the forms did it say anything about the fact that you had to put the money back in within 60 days. So the taxpayer goes to the IRS and says, well, see, here's why you need to give me relief. Because somebody should have told me that, you know, I had to put the money back in within 60 days or I'll pay tax on it. And because I wasn't informed about that, that's the equivalent of the financial institution fouling up, because that is one of the things that can get you basically automatic relief. So because it really is like a, you know, a mistake made by the financial institution, I should be able to put the money back in. Now, here's the catch. The IRS says, first thing, obviously, they say, here's your first problem. Had you gotten those funds from a 401k plan, right, which isn't that simple to do, because most 401k plans don't say you can withdraw, take a short-term loan to buy it, to make a cash offer on a house. That's not normally a reason why you're allowed to take a distribution from the plan. But if you did take an eligible rollover distribution from the plan, they do have to give you notifications about your rollover options. You may remember last week we discussed specifically about the fact that the IRS had issued guidance that included brand new notice forms that deal with this. But there's no such requirement for an IRA custodian to notify their, you know, the customer of the availability of a 60-day rollover when they take a distribution. It's a qualified rollover distribution. And there's, first thing is just basically the law doesn't require it. And probably the law doesn't require it because in many cases, a bank may not know whether or not this will qualify. Why? Remember, for IRAs, we can take a required minimum distribution out of, we treat all of our IRAs as if they're one, and I could take an RMD from any IRAs I want to take it from. And also, the rule applies that the first money out of any IRA starts knocking down the RMD for them all. So arguably, a bank can't know or a brokerage firm cannot know if that distribution coming to you, if you're in an RMD situation, is or is not eligible for rollover treatment. And bottom line, it's like, no, that's just going to confuse issues. And secondly, you know, we know a regular things that happen is people leave employment and they're given the funds and they're going to move it into an IRA. And so it makes sense to tell people about the rules there. But in the case of an IRA, the idea is that we don't really want you taking the funds out of there for the most part. And in fact, you know, we basically make it much more difficult. So we want to kind of encourage you not to take funds out of the IRA. And while we'll still allow the 60-day rollover rule, we're not going to require the custodians to give you this nice long explanation, because in theory, they'd give it to every single retiree for every single distribution and would just confuse matters. And then the IRS says, look, the bottom line, the code says, yes, we can actually waive it, but we can only waive it if the failure to waive the 60-day requirement would be against equity and good conscience. The IRS makes clear, in quotes from committee reports, that the purpose of this rule was not to let you take loans. The purpose of this was purely to let me move an account from Bank of America to Charles Schwab, you know, or something like that. It's not supposed to be something that was meant for other purposes. So the IRS says they do not believe it is against the term being used here, equity or good conscience, to deny relief in a case where you were essentially, it's allowed, but it's effectively an abuse of what was intended. So they say, fine, you can take it out. You can go ahead and, you know, use it for what you want, and you can put the money back in within 60 days, but don't come to us if you miss the 60-day rollover period. And they're very consistent on that holding, and this is just a reminder of that. You know, sometimes you got to be careful about things, and people read about these things they can do online, and quite often, you know, we don't get all these nice little other little problems that go along with it, or somebody tells it. Just like in this case, remember, this whole idea of taking the money from the IRA came from the real estate agent, which, you know, I'm pretty sure the real estate agent probably was not trained in tax law and probably is not a CPA, attorney, EA, or any of the above. And yeah, that's where it gets dangerous. Now, I want to remind you guys of this too, because we'll hit something later today. It also means that as CPAs, we need to be very careful not to decide to go outside of our expertise area, because we can be similarly in trouble. So we want to be careful there. It'll come up when I talk about some PPP loan issues coming up here later. Next up, we're going to revisit the case of Egger versus United States. This is from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals now. We talked about this couple back a year ago when they went to the U.S. District Court in the Northern District of California to appeal their case and say, hey, we should be able to get this break. And when they lost there a year ago, and we talked about it then, but now they went to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. So let's talk about what they were doing. In this case, the taxpayer, I believe it was Mr. Egger, was a real estate professional. And there's no question he met all the requirements. He was a real estate pro. They had a number of rental properties. But in addition, they had three vacation homes. And they registered these vacation homes with a management company that essentially took charge of leasing them out for short periods of time. So these were like in locations like Hawaii and the like, where people would go on vacation. And instead of renting a hotel, they would go ahead and use these vacation homes. Obviously, it would be a situation somewhat like you see with Airbnb and those sorts of issues. So we have these short-term rentals inside of this. Now, obviously, the taxpayer, you know, took these three properties and combined them with their other more standard rentals, treated all as one activity. And these three properties ran at a loss. Now, the IRS in the exam, you know, said, wait a second. You've forgotten about something here. There is a requirement under the issue, under the regulations for passive activities, under Regulation 1.469-1T E3IIIA, tells us about a certain type of arrangement that, while it looks like a real estate rental, won't be treated as one for past activities purposes. And that is one where the average period of customer use is 7 days or less. IRS said, you've got all these people renting this for 2-3 days on average. You're not renting it for more than 7 days to the average customer. So because of that, these three vacation homes are not rentals. Since they're not rentals, they can't be grouped under 469C7 as your rental real estate activity. That means that, and hey, good news, it's not a rental, so it's not automatically passive. Bad news is, whether you combine these three or treat each separately, you don't have enough hours involved for material participation. So these are passive activities. The losses get held. Taxpayers said, no, you misunderstand. The customer here, in this case, as we said, had the short-term rental. The customer here is not those people who live in my properties for 2 to 3 days. Rather, I have a long-term contract, right? A contract for the year with the management company. And so my customer is the management company. And because the term of that rental is more than 7 days, I'm fine, you know, a full year. IRS and, you know, the district court said, no, nobody would really think that this is, you know, basically that the customer is the management company. That's absurd. They simply are your agent who gets you tenants who come in and live for those days and arrange that for you and take care of some details. And you had the right to terminate this contract if you wanted to. You could block off days by just informing them not to rent a period. So obviously the management company didn't have use of this property continuously. And frankly, they weren't using it. They were just getting people who would use it. And you got all that revenue after they charged their effectively commission fee off the top for what they found. So, you know, they lost the district court. They went to the Ninth Circuit. The Ninth Circuit agreed. The Ninth Circuit said first thing, and I love their first comment. They said, look at this arrangement. There's no definition of what customer is in either the code or the regulations under 469. So I said, so we look at the regular and ordinary meaning in that case. And they said, nobody except potentially a tax attorney would ever dream to think in these arrangements that your customer was not the people who are actually living in this place for 2 to 3 days and giving you the cash and basically sending in the cash that came to you, you know, for their use. You know, everybody would look at this in the plain form of how it's structured and believe that honestly, they are merely acting as your agent. So the original district court was correct. Your customer in this case are the actual people in there. They, on average, stayed less than 7 days. Therefore, since the average period of customer use was less than 7 days, these were not a rental. Being not a rental, they can't go in that rental group under 469C7. And we have to, therefore, test this as a separate activity. And as an activity, the district court had found that you didn't materially participate. And you're not even arguing that you would materially participate if these were by themselves. So game, set, match to the IRS. You know, this is not going to be considered to be a valid something to lump into your real estate rental group, even though you're a real estate professional. Tough luck. Next up, we're going to look at the IRS on their website. They updated their webpage, which they've had up for a while, that's titled IRS Operations During COVID-19, Mission Critical Functions Continue. That website's been up all during this thing, starting back in March. But on the 13th of August, they made a revision to the page. And why they revised it is something that we've discussed a lot on the online forums I'm involved in. If any of you have had a client, actually, I think if you haven't had one of these, you're really lucky, who sent, you know, you filed their return electronically with the IRS, and especially trust returns that seem to be affected by this quite a bit. So you filed a trust return on, you know, July 15th, but it could have been earlier, but let's take July 15th filing. And the taxpayer had not set up EFTPS, so we didn't have any way to electronically pay. So what we had them do was go ahead, they wrote the check, sent the check in to pay the tax. If you've done that, almost certainly your client has now received a notice in the past week or so from the IRS stating that they owe the tax plus penalty plus interest because they failed to pay it. Why are they doing that? Because that check is still sitting in a big trailer somewhere waiting to be opened. The IRS has been unable to open those checks. The IRS admits they're unable to do it, right? And there's actually been some stories this week. I believe Kelly Phillips Erb did one of her columns that goes on the Forbes website, specifically talked about this. The IRS said, yeah, we're behind. It's going to take quite a while. We will post them based on date received. At least that's what they claim. And so don't worry about that. These notices will go away. Now, I'll stop on that for just a second. Here's the problem. That's probably what's going to happen. That's probably why your client's thing didn't get in there. But there's always a possibility something else is happening. And we won't know that until your client isn't solved by the time all this stuff straightens out. So by definition, I'm thinking that for the most part, and what I'm going to end up probably doing, is still sending it a letter. Why a letter? Well, you could call, and if you can get through and get it noted on the file, you know, but you have to follow up every so often when they keep doing it, put a hold on anything. And my guess is they don't really want you calling. But I would consider mailing in something to protest that, yes, this was paid. You're not going to be able to send a copy of the canceled check, because if you look for that, it hasn't cleared the bank yet. But say it was timely paid, it went in with it. You know, we need you to search your records, et cetera, to see what's happened to our check and payment voucher. Now, they will not get to that until after they've cleared the check, which I know. But having responded, at least if something else is going on, we can show a timely response. And now it's the IRS that failed to respond to us instead of us failing to respond to the IRS. So that's just my theory on it. So the notice went out anyway. They're in error without questions. So here's your problem. Client wrote a check to pay $5,000 worth of tax. Now it turns out that check's not yet been cashed. Some of our clients, you're probably aware of, are not the best at keeping their bank accounts reconciled nicely up to date. If they look in, you know, they go on the website for the bank and they see $10,000 in the bank, they figure they can write the $8,000 check. Oh, got too much cash in here. I want to go ahead and move it into something that'll pay a higher rate of return. So they go ahead and they take that $10,000, they take $9,000 of it, and send it off somewhere else, not noticing that they've never had that $5,000 check clear. Finally, the IRS gets around to opening the envelope, and bingo, it's going to bounce. So the IRS has now said, because of that, you know, don't call us. I love that. So we're asked not to call. They will waive fees on the dishonored checks that were mailed between April 15th and July 17th. So bottom line, you know, essentially, they claim that they're not going to charge you the standard fee that's charged for a dishonored check. Now, that said, clients should not do anything about these checks. Do not, you know, call the bank and have a stop payment put in. That probably won't get this relief because you stopped payment. You know, it's not because we didn't open it, it's because you stopped payment. That's a different problem. You know, be very careful going there. Let these things go through eventually. Obviously, if the IRS gets too far behind, it may be stale dated. And I'd like to say the bank will catch that. My guess is they won't. But if they do, then I think that would also be protected. But if you took action, I'm a little concerned that the IRS won't be so understanding if you took action to fix something. So be aware of that. Finally, we have three SBA things that came out this week that we'll cover. The SBA updated their FAQs on the 11th of August. And this one is the frequently asked questions from the Small Business Administration for the Paycheck Protection Program loans issued August the 11th, 2020 revision issued on, as we said, August the 11th. Makes sense. This one has two items in it. And so we'll talk, one of which is probably the one that's important to your clients and, you know, and that the other one may get you all riled up, but is not really important to your clients. And that whole area is one we'll deal with. You know, it's a whole other problem outside the scope of this podcast. Payroll costs include, the question was, what exactly counts as healthcare costs? And the concern, I think, from some borrowers was it? Wait, okay. Well, maybe my standard medical policy with my Blue Cross Blue Shield, you know, may that counts. But how about the separate dental insurance policy that I got from, let's say, Delta Dental, or this special vision policy? You know, is that vision care policy or that dental policy, are those considered healthcare items? And basically, and it's the funniest FAQ question, because, you know, it has us going down, you know, do the following count as payroll costs, right? And they talk about, you know, do health costs include payments for premiums for medical insurance, including premiums paid for dental coverage and visit coverage? The answer is very simple. Just says yes, done, go on. That's the simplest answer ever you'll find in one of these. The other one that came out, as I said, the one that gets people all riled up, it's just the SBA talking about what happens if a bank has or has not paid a fee to a third party. You know, those third party fees for assisting in handling the loans, and the bank, which the banks basically are not paying, period. And I know there's some CPAs very worked up about that. Not for my discussion, not my issue. You guys have it, whoever you want it with, but it's outside the IRC and outside why I'm talking about the PPP loans. I'll phrase it that way. So I know, and I'm not, because it's a legal question, and I will put it this way: the banks view it that they have to invite a third party in, and the CPAs weren't invited, and they have to negotiate up front. That's their view. But in any event, I think there are some lawsuits going on and other issues. There were some lenders who may have been concerned that if they hadn't paid it in these lawsuits, that the SBA might not pay them while that was in dispute. The flip side of it, some may be concerned that if they had paid it, that somehow that could get them in trouble. The SBA says right up front, they are not, for the purpose of paying off the loan, you know, paying off whatever portion they determine should be forgiven, or for the purpose of giving the bank the gross fee, because these third-party fees come out of the bank's gross fees, the SBA is not going to reduce gross fees, not going to reduce the amount they're going to pay for the basically for to pay off the debt, you know, regardless of what's happened with third-party fees. That if there is a problem, some enforcement issue, that would be handled separately, but it's not going to put your basic participation at risk. Okay, next up. We did get another FAQ modification on loan forgiveness. This came out of it again on August the 11th. They modified this as well. And this is the first thing we got that clearly talks about the EIDL advances, right? Remember that up to $10,000 advance you could get, what was supposed to be an advance on your EIDL loan. And in theory, it was to be integrated in some way with the PPP loans. Now, the law literally says that your forgiveness is reduced by the amount of this grant that you get. Okay. For a while, the SBA started talking as if, well, what it means is we'll just reduce your PPP loan by whatever you got as a grant, which, okay, would have understood how that worked. The problem was they got so wildly behind in processing EIDL grants that the PPP loans all went out before the first grants went out. So now we've got a problem as to how it's going to work. So the SBA is back more the way the law is written. And this makes it clear. All we knew so far was on the forgiveness, we were going to tell the SBA that there was an EIDL loan out there. The bank was to do nothing with that initially. They were determined forgiveness, ignoring all that. They would then send it on to the SBA, who would, you know, take a look at what the bank had done and would be notified about that EIDL loan. Well, what this fact tells us is it tells the bank that the bank will be notified the amount of the forgiveness, and that amount of forgiveness will be, first time this has been, I figured it was going this way, but this absolutely confirms it. So if you were given an $8,000 EIDL grant, and you got a PPP loan otherwise, and it was for $100,000, and you did everything to be fully forgiven, the bank would send it in to the SBA saying full forgiveness, $100,000. The SBA would come back to the bank and say, we're going to give you $92,000 plus interest, et cetera, whatever, on the $92,000. However, $8,000 of the loan will not be forgiven, so you need to collect that along with the interest, et cetera, over the 2-year or 5-year term. So it will be the offset, The bank will not do the offset because they don't know what your grant is. The SBA does, because the SBA handled the grants directly. So that's where we go. They made it very clear. They talk about the remaining balance of the loan is to be treated as just due. So as I told people, basically what we're saying is you're going to have to pay, you know, in essence, you're going to have to pay back the EIDL grant. Even though in theory it was a grant you didn't have to repay, the reality is if you got a PPP loan, you are effectively going to repay the EIDL grant. Now, they also said if you got an EIDL grant in excess of the PPP loan, then, you know, you owe the whole PPP loan back, but don't worry about the excess. Now, probably most people did not get a PPP loan. Who got a PPP loan did not get one that was less than their grant. You know, it's like because the grant was going to be a maximum of $10,000, you would have had to have 10 employees, and it seems highly unlikely that we have 10 employees, but we couldn't qualify for 10 grand of EIDL grants. I guess if you were a startup, there may be some odd ways that you can make that work, but I would say in 99.99% of the cases, no, our PPP loan will be much greater than our EIDL grant. But what this tells us is for those taxpayers or those borrowers, non-borrowers, I guess we'd say this, who did not get a PPP loan but got the grant, there's some of those out there, that, yeah, they don't owe anything back. As long as you didn't get a PPP loan, you don't owe anything back. But if you got a PPP loan, you're going to have to pay, you essentially have to pay back your grant. That's not how it's written. That's not how it's sold. But it's from a practical standpoint what you have to do. If you got a PPP loan, you have to pay back the EID grant because that much of your PPP loan will not be forgiven. Yeah, that's how I figured it had to work from early on, especially when they couldn't get to the offsets early. And that's really what they said. You got to do that. It's the only option you've got. So don't worry about that. It doesn't matter about how this works. Finally, this one I want to warn you about, but I am going to tell you about it because it's important to know. There's a new interim final rule, RIN 3245-AH55, appeals of SBA loan review decisions under the Paycheck Protection Program from the SBA came out again on same day, August the 11th. Now, warning about this. When we do this, this is not covered for CPAs, EAs, under your standard ability to practice before the Treasury, because that practice under CERC 230 and under the enabling language, in fact, you're going to find that, as a recall, it's sitting there in Title 5 United States Code. Let me make sure I've got that, if I remember where it goes. Title 5 United States Code, I forget what the remainder of it is, but it's not covered by that, okay? So, problem is, and you'll read this, the only option that the SBA provides is the borrower could do this appeal on their own to the SBA, or they can have an attorney represent them. There is nothing in here that allows any other third party to be the representative. If you do it, I think there's a real risk you could be, you know, you could get in trouble. Depending upon the rules in your state, it could very well be seen to be the unauthorized practice of law. And certainly if anything goes wrong, I guarantee you that your client's going to claim that you were involved in the unauthorized practice of law. You should have referred this out to legal counsel. Finally, I don't think most of us are specialists in SBA loan review procedures. This is a procedure that takes place after the bank has reviewed your loan document and they make an initial determination of your forgiveness. It goes up to the SBA and the SBA issues what is referred to as a final SBA loan review decision. There are four things you can appeal. You can appeal, first thing is you can't appeal anything until this final decision is issued. So you cannot, if the bank says you get no forgiveness, you still got to wait for the SBA. The SBA will see that and will say yes or no to the bank on that position. You cannot file the appeal at that point. You have to wait for this to go on. Now, you can appeal an SBA final decision that you were never eligible for the loan to begin with. You weren't eligible for the loan to begin with. All kinds of things bad could happen to you, but certainly you're going to have to pay it back. So you could appeal that decision. You could also appeal a decision that you were ineligible for the total loan proceeds. So let's say the SBA looks at your loan application. I think we are going to see a number of these, unfortunately, where they say, well, you got $300,000 in loan proceeds, but really, based on the 2.5-month rule, you should have only gotten $200,000. So $100,000 of that is you're just not eligible for it. Or the second thing is you misuse the loan proceeds. And we've already seen prosecutions on that, you know, where somebody went out, got a PPP loan, and then was out there buying luxury cars. We've had a few of those. You know, you misused it. Remember, a PPP loan, it's not just if you don't pay the payroll cost, you have to pay back over 5 years. No, it's that you still have to use it for an authorized purpose, even if you don't use it within the time period for, you know, for the costs that are forgiven. In reality, the only thing that counts as an authorized use, as I recall, that is not a forgivable cost. Well, there are two ways to get there. One way to get there is just to pay, you know, have less than 80% be payroll costs. That's because obviously 80% of the forgiveness amount has to be payroll costs. So that's possible. But the other uses would still be allowed. If you used every dollar of your loan to pay, you know, interest on the pre-existing mortgage, or use every dollar to pay, you know, for your rent, then fine. You know, that's good. It's still an authorized use. You just won't get forgiveness. The other thing you can do is interest on unsecured debt is authorized, but it never can count for forgiveness. So those are cases you can do it. But if you took the money from this and you just used it for, I don't know, you know, to buy inventory, then that's an unauthorized use. That's a misuse of the proceeds. If the SBA determines that all or some portion you're not eligible for forgiveness of after the banks determine you should be forgiven, or there's a full denial by the lender and the SBA makes a ruling to say yes, no, whatever on that, yes, or it's partial, those are only four you can do. Now, at that point, when that happens, you have a 30-day deadline to file. And there are very detailed requirements for filing. If you don't provide the information that's required, the regulations allow the administrative law judge or the administrative judge to essentially dismiss the appeal with prejudice if they want, which means it can't be refiled. It can be dismissed with or without prejudice. So fouling this up could be a very expensive mistake, because it could be your client was correct that they should not have had this happen to them, but it's possible that by filing up the filing, they could cause this to be unable to be pursued. I strongly suggest you need to know these rules, but you need to know them primarily so your client can say, you know, I think you need to consider getting legal counsel and pursuing this, because I don't know how successful a borrower is going to be on their own in most of these cases, because, you know, people, the batting average of pro se taxpayers in the tax court is really bad, and I got to believe be really bad here as well. But, you know, we do have to figure out, does it make sense? You know, if they're going to be concerned because the bank says they have to repay $1,000, I think bottom line, you're going to say, yeah, I know it's probably not right, but it's going to cost you more than $1,000 to pursue it. So just pay it. We do things like that. That's how we'll do it. So you have the 30-day deadline for filing it. The other thing to remember that's interesting here is if you decide to appeal it, the decisions will be published. So your client has to understand going to appeals may cause certain things to be disclosed that the client may not like. At least it'll become public if somebody wanted to look at it. So be aware of that. Now, again, as I said, this is not because I believe CPAs should be involved as direct representatives. CPAs probably will have to support legal counsel, you know, in terms of helping getting information as legal counsel indicates what has to be put together. But it is something to, you know, but it's not something for the CPA to lead. I think that's probably the best way to phrase it. Well, we got some more CPE courses coming up. If you're really quick and hear this early, I will be doing an Arizona Society course on Monday the 17th for partnership taxation advanced issues. And again, everything I'm talking about at this point is still going to be virtual, remote, no live courses. I'm not aware of anybody anywhere offering live courses yet. And that includes state societies and other places people may get continuing education. It's all virtual. So I'll do 8 hours on partnership taxation advanced issues. I will do a very similar course in for the Montana Society on August 26th. Also, you know, virtual, 8 hours, advanced partnership issues featuring the new audit regime. I'll also, on the 27th, be doing the income taxation of trusts and estates, the same type of course I did for Arizona last week. And finally, I'll also be doing a very similar course what I did for Arizona last week on August the 28th, qualified business income and more. Those will be coming up. And I am going to be doing a course that we just added on September 1st for New Jersey Society of CPAs, PPP loan forgiveness and other recent COVID-19 developments. All of these can be signed up for on the Applicable State Society's website. So you want to go check those and see about signing up and going there. This has been the current developments for the week of August 17th. Don't get too far ahead of myself this year. I think we just want this year to go away quickly, but it's still around. So you can catch our updates at currentfilletaxdevelopments.com online. If you have questions or comments, send them to me, Ed Zollers at currentfilletaxdevelopments.com. My Twitter handle is at Ed Zollers. I follow discussions online for the Connect groups for Arizona, New Jersey, Minnesota, Washington, Illinois, and Minnesota. So you can write there. If you have questions, you can participate in those sites and go for it. I also take a look at Cal CPA's Tax Talk group from time to time, and we'll look in there. Until then, we'll wait till next week, see what happens. The Senate did leave town, so apparently we're not going to expect any new bill really quick. We'll see what happens. We've been told that if they actually do come to a compromise, they'll come back and vote. But I'm not really betting we'll have a law by this time next week. But if we do, we'll talk about it. So we'll go down that path. Otherwise, we'll be back here to talk about whatever other developments we have in the area of federal taxes for the following week.